So, meine Damen und Herren, die zweite Runde beginnt und wir wenden uns nun etwas genauer der Europäischen Union, der Rolle der Europäischen Union, ihren Instrumenten im Erweiterungsprozess zu. Eingangs deutete sich ja ein Dissens an zwischen einer Ausgangsthese, die wir im Einladungstext verfasst haben, dass möglicherweise doch Abschläge zu beobachten sind hinsichtlich der demokratischen Substanz der Länder, wenn denn andere Gesichtspunkte wie Zugehörigkeit zum westlichen Lager, Stabilität in der Region gewährleistet sind. Herr Erler hat das vehement bestritten, gesagt, es gibt keine Abschläge oder es gibt keine Rabatte. Das wollen wir jetzt auch näher erörtern, wenn auch ich das Gefühl hatte, in der ersten Runde wurde schon verschiedentlich darauf hingewiesen, dass mindestens von den Gästen, die wir aus der Region haben, deutliche Zweifel in dieser Frage geäußert worden. Wie wollen wir vorgehen? Wir haben etwa drei Komplexe, die wir in einem ersten Durchgang hier auf dem Podium besprechen wollen. Und dann öffnen wir zu Ihnen, zu Ihren Fragen. Wir hatten bis jetzt noch nicht die Gelegenheit, über Mazedonien zu sprechen. Mazedonien hat aber, was für Balkanländer ja nicht so oft vorkommt, im Augenblick Schlagzeilen produziert. Deswegen nehmen wir die gute Gelegenheit wahr, dass wir Sascha Odanonski bei uns haben und bitten ihn um eine kurze Präsentation über die Situation, aktuelle Situation in den vergangenen zwei Monaten in Mazedonien. Wir werden dann die Frage erörtern, die in der Presse, und wir haben Vertreterinnen der Presse hier auf dem Podium, die in der Presse vertreten wurden, nämlich die Europäische Union ist schuld an dieser Entwicklung in Mazedonien, an den dokumentierten Rückschritten, wenn man auf die Reporter ohne Grenzen oder World Freedom Press Index achtet, auf die dokumentierten Rückschritte achtet, dann ist die Europäische Union schuld, weil sie seit vielen, vielen Jahren mit den Beitrittsverhandlungen mit Mazedonien nicht begonnen hat, obwohl die Kommission Jahr für Jahr empfiehlt, mit diesen Beitrittsverhandlungen zu beginnen. Dann wenden wir uns in der zweiten Runde der Frage zu, warum denn in Bezug auf Medienfreiheit auch Länder, die bereits mit den Beitrittsverhandlungen begonnen haben, wir haben da insbesondere Montenegro und Serbien, auch deutliche Rückschritte in der Medienfreiheit zu verzeichnen sind. Also eine richtige Garantie kann die Eröffnung der Beitrittsverhandlungen natürlich nicht sein. Also wie erklären sich dort die Rückschritte und sind da nicht möglicherweise hinsichtlich sozusagen der Erfolge, die in den Progress-Reports, die die Kommission Jahr für Jahr produziert, die Erfolge, die dort dokumentiert werden, sozusagen auch die Abstriche in der demokratischen Substanz, bei den demokratischen Grundrechten, sozusagen schon mit einkalkuliert. Und dann wenden wir uns also näher den Instrumenten zu, den sogenannten Sticks and Carrots. Was hat die Europäische Union anzubieten, um die Länder sozusagen voranzutreiben bei der demokratischen Transformation? Und was hat sie ihnen anzubieten? Welche Anreize hat sie ihnen anzubieten? Was steht wirklich zur Verfügung? Von den Fonds bis zu den, wir werden darüber über die möglichen Instrumente sprechen. Und schließlich haben wir noch eine interessante Frage zu stellen. Die Länder des Balkans thematisieren selber sehr oft, insbesondere der serbische Außenminister sehr gerne, dass die Europäische Union ja selber unklare oder keine Standards hat. Dass sie mit Bezug auf die Medienfreiheit oder auch andere sozusagen demokratische Grundfreiheiten höchst gespalten sei. Und er verweist sehr gerne in diesem Zusammenhang auf ein Land, das seit 2007 Mitglied der Europäischen Union ist, auf Bulgarien, und sagt, wir lernen daraus, dass ihr offensichtlich sozusagen mit mehreren Standards arbeitet. Und wir werden dann über die Frage sprechen, warum sozusagen die Europäische Union dem bisher nicht hat abhelfen können, obwohl sie verschiedene Schritte unternommen hat. Bulgarien und auch Rumänien sozusagen an mindestens höhere Standards heranzuführen. Welche Diskussionen in der Europäischen Union bestanden, existieren oder in der letzten Zeit geführt wurden, auch etwa mit Blick auf Ungarn, ein Land, das auch in Bezug auf Medienfreiheit und demokratische Grundrechte deutliche Rückschritte zu verzeichnen hat. Wie kann man intervenieren? Es hat verschiedene europäische Initiativen gegeben. Wir werden darüber kurz berichten. Es ist dann aber doch so, dass die europäischen Mitgliedsländer der Kommission letztlich nicht die Kompetenz zusprechen wollten, da zu intervenieren. Ein Land wie Deutschland mag nicht einen Report aus Brüssel bekommen über die demokratischen Grundfreiheiten und entsprechend ist das auch verhindert worden mit Bezug auf Bulgarien, mit Bezug auf Rumänien und Ungarn etwa. Aber genauso, was die Medienfreiheit anbetrifft, mit Bezug auf Italien, das sozusagen bei allen Indizes sozusagen auch einen grottenschlechten Stand eigentlich hat. Also, was ist mit den Instrumenten in der Europäischen Union und warum kommen wir da nicht weiter? Und warum sozusagen, weil es einen Mangel oder eine mangelnde Bereitschaft gibt, der Europäischen Union, der Kommission mehr Kompetenzen zu geben, warum hängt denn so viel dann mindestens in Gestalt von Erwartungen an den sogenannten führenden Ländern der Europäischen Union? Wir haben durch den ganzen Tag heute Gespräche geführt, bei denen immer wieder angesprochen wurde, dass erst große Erwartungen an die deutsche Regierung, an die Reise der Bundeskanzlerin in den Balkan in 4 Wochen gerichtet werden, was damit ja auch zu tun hat, dass eben die Länder wie die Bundesrepublik für sich weiter diese Kompetenzen beanspruchen und in diesen Fragen gewissermaßen sozusagen den Maßstab zu setzen und das nicht an die Europäische Union zu geben. Also das ist sozusagen der Kontext. Ich habe Sascho noch nicht vorgestellt. Sascho, er ist Journalist, er hat ein privates TV-Programm als Managing Director geleitet, ein staatliches. Er leitet den Bereich Medien und Public Relations, einem privaten Unternehmen. Er unterrichtet an der Universität Journalism und Communication Skills und ist Standing President von Transparency in Mazedonien. Dann gehen wir weiter zu Adelina Marini. Sie hat lange Zeit für den Bulgarischen, sie stammt aus Bulgarien, hat lange Zeit für den bulgarischen Rundfunk gearbeitet, viele 15, 14 Jahre. Dann hat sie das sehr, wie ich finde, informative Portal EU Insight, www.euinsight.eu gegründet, für das sie der Editor-in-Chief ist. Und sie lebt heute in Kroatien und hat ihren ursprünglichen Fokus auf die Region Bulgarien, Rumänien immer weiter ausgedehnt, auch dann auf dem Western Balkan. Und sehr viele interessante Artikel über sozusagen Diskussionen in Brüssel über die europäische Erweiterungspolitik geschrieben. Dann habe ich neben mir Adelheid Wölfel, sie ist Journalistin und ist die Auslandskorrespondentin des österreichischen Standard. Sie lebt in Sarajevo und ist sozusagen, fühlt sich schreibend zuständig eigentlich für den ganzen westlichen Balkan. Herzlich willkommen auch an Sie. Und schließlich ganz großen Dank an Manuel Sarrazin, er ist der europapolitische Sprecher der Grünen im Deutschen Bundestag und entsprechend im Europaausschuss, dass er sehr kurzfristig noch zugesagt hat. Wir hatten ursprünglich jemanden aus der Europäischen Kommission versucht zu gewinnen. Ich finde, angesichts sozusagen der mangelnden Kompetenzen der Kommission und der großen Erwartungen, die an nationale Parlamente und Regierungen gestellt werden, ist geradezu angemessen, dass wir so einen sagen nationalen Europapolitiker hier haben, der als Grüner natürlich wahrscheinlich eher darunter leiden wird, dass der Kommission gewisse Kompetenzen vorenthalten werden. Soweit sozusagen der Überblick, was wir hier vorhaben. Ich bitte Sascho erst einmal mit seiner Präsentation zu beginnen.
Well, can we get the other slide, the general slide, if you don't mind? Then we'll follow this. No, not the previous one, the general slide of the conference. You can't do it. Okay. Okay, doesn't matter. If it's going to be a long night if we answer all these questions that Andreas is posing to us, so be prepared. Yes, thank you. While I'm talking about these few questions, and of course I'm not even intending to cover everything that was mentioned, I'm going to show you some slides about the violence in Macedonia in the last 45 days, because we are talking about the freedom of the press, freedom of expression, so it's always good to have the visualization of the problems. Let's see which one works. Okay. I'm not going to comment them because you can read everything well enough. From the first day they entered the office, the Macedonian government in 2006 in July, the current Macedonian government, which is now going in July to enter its 10th year, a decade in power in Macedonia, they were very clear among themselves. They didn't want to join European Union. Publicly, they were saying everything on the contrary, but privately and among themselves, they had a different project in their mind. They had the project of a big redistribution of power and material wealth in the state. And that process, that platform, that program was impossible to be delivered if they continued the efforts to join the European Union. On NATO, they were benevolent. If it happened, okay. If it didn't happen, okay again. But on EU, they had a very clear idea. They didn't want to do it. In order to make this huge engineering project, they, of course, needed EU as far as possible from the Macedonian institutions. Because the next phase of Macedonian entering and getting closer to the European Union meant that people from Brussels would come in all of Macedonian institutions and then closely watch what was going on in institutions and how the reforms are progressing. Of course, they were not interested for that. Because of that, Macedonia is one of the rare countries in Europe, these days not so much, but especially 9 years ago, where you had populists in power. You know, populist parties in Europe, usually in Western Europe, are mostly smaller parties. They're either very junior partners in the government or they're opposition parties, where you actually do not have their influence on the main major agenda in the countries. For the first time, we had a fully fledged populist government in power with the majority in the parliament, which was governing the country. I'm not going to go through theoretical and practical things, what happened in Macedonia, how they govern, three major pillars, and so on and so forth. But one thing is necessary to understand, and I think that we do understand, most of us, especially after the previous session, in populism, the narrative is the key of politics. In every politics, narrative is also important. But since populists are not democrats, they need a total control of the narrative. The narrative needs to be like a ball. It has to be consequent. It doesn't need any kind of holes. It needs to be provable. It needs to be very strongly presented to public because it has to mesmerize the public. Why? Because the narrative is, in populism, one of the key things is how you mobilize your support. So narrative and then media, and then media control was the key thing that from the very first day when they entered the office, they knew that they will have completely to take under control. In Macedonian case, it took a couple of years until they did actually the first efforts in this area. And then in 2010, they closed the biggest private TV, which was the most viewed TV, and which was the most influential TV, which was starting to criticize the government. After 2010, when they closed it down, they arrested the owner, they arrested the whole management of this TV, allegedly, and then proved, because of the tax evasion, but then all of their media were doing the same things, tax evasion. So they, very arbitrary did the whole thing. It was then easier. Then Westere Allgemeine Zeitung, WAZ Group, German group, which was owning the three biggest dailies, sold their property to the local power machine of the government. Now the government owns this three media. And then through various other channels, they succeeded since 2010, 2011 to control 90 to 95% of the media in the country. How does it look like? Macedonian government is the biggest advertiser according to the official statistics on the Macedonian media market. So they're spending between 1 to 1.5% of the state budget annually on propaganda. I'm not going to tell you the absolute numbers, but imagine if Ms. Merkel, how big is the German budget? How many trillions? Now, imagine if they spend 1% of the budget on propaganda. It would be a lot. How much? Is it 1%?
No, it's more.
It's more. Well, in a small country like Macedonia, with a current budget which is lower than 3 billion a year, they spend millions on buying time in the media. They actually don't buy time. They bought practically most of the private TVs and most of the press industry in the country, in the media. So through that period, they were controlling everything. Since 2006 until last year, so for 8 years, we had 8 elections. Every year, election. For the populist, mobilization is very important. So elections are a method how they mobilize people. In populism, you see, they do not do elections because there is a chance that they would lose the elections. But they always do very often elections to prove that there is no alternative than they are. So these are one of the people were talking about the institutions. Populists do not cancel institutions; they simply overjump it, or they circumvent, so they filled all of the institutions with party people. We live today in a total partocracy. In 2006, when they entered the government, the state administration numbered 96,000 people. Macedonia, just to remember you, it's less than 2 million people. Since then to now, the state administration number is close to 200,000 people. So this kind of huge machinery of vested interests, of clientelism, is actually securing them on any elections whenever they are called, coupled with the total control of the media to win any election any time in the year, any day, at night. So that's how they totally misuse the public funds, they totally control the administration, plus a huge program of subsidies to the agriculture sector, and so on and so forth. Why I'm saying this? I'm saying this just to show you that talking on the media, and then we'll come to the European Union as well, because that's the same. So the problems are structural. It's not the problem now. I'm listening not only today, but all my life practically, market problems, this and that, and so on and so forth, influences and so on. Problems are structural. They cannot be dealt with only with political measures before the elections. We need a total reconstruction of the media system. And that's a very difficult job if you do not have a political will behind that. Secondly, we do not have media markets. We have media schemes. So you cannot discuss about the media market like you are talking in Germany. Because market forces are not present on the. It's simply a media scheme, it's a media schematology, how you buy influence and how you sell ideas. And that's something totally different. So if you approach that from the market perspective, it's not going to function. So, in other words, when the European Union came as a big agenda and so on and so forth, they already were in the total power of the society. They simply called the bluff. The bluff to the European Union, to Brussels, is what do you do if the government doesn't want to join the European Union? You sit in Brussels, you have a candidate country like Macedonia, and you have a government which is unofficially saying, we don't care about what you say. And you see that European Union does not have measures to counteract this kind of behavior. They can advise, they can say, they can threat. If you're a small country, unimportant like Macedonia, nobody's actually interested. And eventually it comes down to, well, if you don't want to join, then it's your problem. So who cares? And this is precisely what comes perfectly into the hands of the populists and of the anti-European forces in our countries in the Balkans. That's why you have a spreading of these autocratic regimes all around the region. Of course that their idols in politics are Putin and Erdogan. Of course that the only person, foreign dignitary, who actually got the state highest order, how do you say order, was the Hungarian prime minister. Of course that then they're, you know, they're practicing their governance totally into this kind of a framework within the system of governance. Everything changed some 6 months ago when the opposition came up publicly with the phone tapping materials. The opposition somehow got, we can go in details, but it's not of the essence now at this discussion. They got 120,000 phone tapped conversations, which were done by the Macedonian secret police in the last 5 to 6 years. They were phone tapping 26,000 phone numbers. If somebody is interested about the details, how it was done technically, we can discuss it, but I don't think that it is important. So far, the opposition had 35 press conferences. So far, we have heard more than 400 phone tapping conversations. They have more than 60,000 SMSs also in their possession. When you, of course, in undemocratic regimes, the clique in power, and in our case, it's a relative connected clique. So the chief of the Secret Service is the first relative of the prime minister. The chief of the organized crime prosecution is the godfather to the chief of the Secret Service. The minister of interior, her husband works as advisor in the prime minister's office. His best friend is a minister of finance. The minister of finance's wife is, and so on and so forth. With the Supreme Court, with the Constitutional Court, with all institutions. So it was not only that they were members of the same party, but like in a mafia, the loyalty needed to be family. Now this family, which is governing Macedonia, is a totally criminal family. They had the need not only to phone tap me, my dossier is this big. They did everything that I did in the last 5, 6 years. But they were dedicating equally time to their first friends and collaborators. The only two phones which were not phone tapped was the phone of the prime minister and of the chief of the secret service. Because you see, in the undemocratic rulings, in the undemocratic authorities, the real danger doesn't come from the opposition. It comes from your table. It comes from your friends, from your ministers, from your political allies. They spent a lot of time in phone tapping them. The story goes that every morning, the chief of the cabinet of the chief of the secret service, every morning was going to the prime minister's office with a special computer, which was showing the most interesting 10, 15, 20, 100 talks from the last day. And they were doing every morning, they were doing a schedule for tomorrow, who will be. So you can imagine, it's very easy to make politics when you know what you're, especially in the, for instance, election days. When you know totally your position is transparent and you know everything, not only from their political life, but from their private life as well. Now, if you add to that kind of information, all other kinds of information that the state has inside it, I don't know, health service, tax office, voting systems, criminal records, and so on and so forth, you get a totally powerful system which you actually cannot fight. Now, with this action of, this is me, by the way, doesn't matter. Well, with this kind of system started to fall apart when the opposition started to publicize these things. Because look, not only that we heard 400 phone tapped conversations, out of these 400, probably some 300 are between ministers. And each conversation is like, you know, from 2 minutes to 20 minutes long. Then you hear very unpleasant things. The details of criminal doings, the details of fixing elections, the details of, from murders to racketeering, everything that you can imagine. Well, I don't know, maybe Germany politicians are also talking these things on the phone. But the fact of the matter is that when they are caught and when few of these things are published, then the same afternoon they leave the office. In Macedonia, the government said no. We are not going to make any comment on this. We reject the content of the phone tappings, and we're going to arrest the leader of the opposition. So currently, they took his passport. They arrested 4 or 5 people around him. they're under the coup d'etat criminal charges, and the case is going on, and they're adding a new case every second week on this, on that, and so on and so forth. And now, with the mediating of the European Commissioner, they're negotiating about the conditions of the further democracy in Macedonia. So, you know, when you ask them, how do you negotiate with mafia? Is there any mafia which would go down by negotiations? The mafia which is beating people, which is, this is only in the last 40 days I'm showing to you. This is not, you know, a story that goes on with years. This is only in the last 40 days I collected several cases. So this is the nature of the regime we are fighting for. As a result, you see, I'm not even touching the European Union agenda, but we'll come back to that. As a result, now in Macedonia, there is a big wave of a real, genuine citizen movement, which is only partly related to the opposition. They accept this far that the opposition is representing them, but they're actually beyond the opposition, and it's growing, and plus it's multi-ethnic. You will see Macedonian, Albanian, Turkish, and Roma flag and Serbian flag together connected on the demonstrations. We have everyday demonstrations in Skopje. A couple of times it was violent. It was violent because the government sent provocateurs among the protesters just to provoke this. So now we're in this phase where we say, look, we will continue our democracy and continue European Union talks, whatever, only under one condition. This prime minister and his clique needs to go down. Then we need 10 months, 12 months of expert government, which will prepare for the next April, early extraordinary elections. But we are not going to accept that these people prepare early elections, because these people, we've seen enough evidence that they're up to here in any criminality you can imagine. So, what is the reaction of the European Union to all these kind of things? You have Commissioner Hahn. Commissioner Hahn, I'm a journalist, I'm representing only myself, so I'm not speaking on behalf of any institution, so that's why I'm free to say, yeah. When you see in Commissioner Hahn's biography, you will see that he was, among other things, general manager of one of the biggest chains of casinos in Austria. So it's another matter how comes that the chief of the casinos is becoming commissioner of EU, but that's for you to discuss. But those casinos have big operation in Macedonia in many years. And they are very closely connected with what the government, because in any country, casinos are highly licensed businesses, so you cannot do it just like that. So now suddenly we have a Commissioner Hahn mediating negotiations between the mafia and the opposition. Well, I'm not going to comment that. I'm just giving you pure facts. Maybe, look, the guy was probably totally decent, but me sitting in Skopje with car burned, I'm just asking questions, you know. Suddenly I'm afraid of any connection. So this is the point where we are now standing at this point. Tomorrow in Brussels, there should be the next meeting between the opposition and the government mediated by Mr. Hahn. I personally believe that those negotiations are going to end without any positive ending. And I think that very soon in Macedonia, we're going to need a kind of a special envoy, which will have to be a kind of a joint EU-American kind of thing, which will, with more forcefully and with a much more clear mandate, try to negotiate the closing down of this government, then some time of experts who will lead the country till the next elections, and then next elections. The last thing I would say is this. Look, in your country, in Germany, people were fighting on the streets for liberty, for freedom. And I don't know how comes that the leftist movements lost this kind of motivation. Why should only nationalists fight on the streets, fight with police and with this and that? Now we are getting back to Skopje, and I can tell you that if these negotiations fail, many people are prepared to get out on the street and fight for the freedom. Because they have either that choice or the choice of packing the bags and coming to Germany. Thank you. Let me see whether you have some other. No, this was the last slide. Thank you. I mean, I will probably This is what I wanted to comment. What is this white package on the last newspaper there? It looks like a drug, some kind of a narcotics or... Yeah? I mean, it may be just a... yeah, it does look like... Is that so? Okay.
Ja, danke für die Einladung. Ich möchte damit anfangen, da ich viel in der Region unterwegs bin, wie wirklich wichtig Deutschland dort gesehen wird und wie viele Erwartungen und Hoffnungen damit verbunden sind. Ich bin gerade von einer Reise zurückgekommen aus Albanien, Kosovo und Mazedonien und war gerade Papstbesuch in Sarajevo und meine Freunde, das Erste, was sie zu mir gesagt haben, sie kommt. Da sage ich, wer kommt? Die Merkel kommt. Also vergiss den Papst, die Merkel kommt. Das war so die erste Aussage. Und das, diese unglaubliche Erwartung, die natürlich unrealistisch ist, dass die Frau Merkel und Deutschland alles richten wird, ist aber trotzdem auch ein Indikator für mich dafür, wie viel trotzdem noch an Vertrauen in die EU da ist und speziell in Deutschland. Und ich glaube, dass mit diesem Vertrauen eben auch eine Verantwortung erwächst. Ich denke mir eben, diese Mediensituation, wie sie heute hier geschildert worden ist, ist nämlich nicht nur ein Indikator für die Freiheit in diesen Staaten, beziehungsweise für die Unfreiheit, sondern sie wird von den Menschen vor Ort wahrgenommen als Indikator für den Erfolg oder den Misserfolg der Europäischen Union. Und je weiter, je schlechter diese Mediensituation ist, desto weiter weg fühlen sich diese Menschen von Europa. Und meine Erfahrung ist so in den letzten Jahren, wenn ich mit Diplomaten rede vor Ort, dass die sich, also Diplomaten aus der EU, auch stark von Brüssel im Stich gelassen fühlen. Vor Ort kommen die nämlich ziemlich unter Druck. Es gibt EU-Diplomaten, auch deutsche Diplomaten. Ich erinnere mich an das Beispiel zum Beispiel vom Pius Fischer in Montenegro, der dann plötzlich auch auf einem von diesen Zeitungen da, falls man die so nennen kann, gelandet ist. Der Schelko wird sich auch erinnern. Und gegen den eine Kampagne gestartet worden ist. Und das heißt eben für mich, dass das nicht hoch genug eingeschätzt werden kann, wie wichtig das für die Leute vor Ort ist, wie die EU reagiert. Jetzt wurde die Frau Lukic hat das schon erwähnt, dieses berühmte Zitat vom Herrn Hahn zur Medienfreiheit in Serbien. Ich wollte noch einmal kurz darauf zurückkommen. Er hat damals vor ein paar Monaten gesagt, nachdem es eben massive Beschwerden gab in Serbien. Und ich frage immer nach dem Beweis. Ich bin gewillt, solchen Vorwürfen nachzugehen, aber ich brauche Beweise und nicht nur Gerüchte. Daraufhin hat der Herr Vucic, also der serbische Premierminister, gesagt, dass den Herrn Hahn gelobt und ihm gesagt, dass es sich hier um eine Person handelt, die dem Druck der Medien trotzen würde. Bekannt wurde auch dieser Konflikt in den letzten Monaten zwischen dem Premierminister Vucic und den Reportern von Balkan Investigative Report Network in Birn, denen vorgeworfen wurde, eine Kampagne gegen die Regierung zu führen. Und zwar, da ging es um einen Stromversorger, der einen Vertrag mit einem Konsortium abgeschlossen hat, der wieder einem Geschäftsmann nahesteht, der wiederum Vucic nahesteht, darüber hat Birn geschrieben. Und dann ist es so weit gegangen,
und dass... Und wenn ich das ergänzen darf, keine Expertise in dem Feld hat, für das er den Job bekommen hat.
Genau, ja. Und dann ging es so weit, dass der Herr Vucic behauptet hat, dass der EU-Botschafter in Serbien, der Michael Davenport, und die Sprecherin der EU-Außenbeauftragten, die Maja Kocijančić, das Birn verwenden würde, um den Vucic zu diskreditieren. Was ich damit sagen will, ist, dass es hier schon lange nicht mehr darum geht, dass um ein lokales Problem, ja, sondern dass diese Politik, ja, mit Hilfe dieser Verlautbarungsorgane, die die da aufgebaut haben in den letzten Jahren, diese Zeitungen, die eigentlich nicht Medien sind, sondern Verlautbarungsorgane von Parteien oder Regierungen, dass die mit Hilfe von diesen nicht nur die kritischen Journalisten und die NGOs, sondern auch durchaus Vertreter der EU beziehungsweise die europäischen Werte, oder Werte ist auch noch zu wenig gesagt, auch sozusagen die Forderungen, die aus der EU kommen, bekämpfen. Was es deswegen meiner Meinung nach wirklich braucht, es sind Politiker aus der Europäischen Union, die klare Worte finden. Und zwar deswegen, weil das nicht nur die Leute vor Ort schützt. Ich bin in einer privilegierten Situation, ich bin Österreicher, mich kann man da nicht so leicht einschränken, aber ich kenne die Kollegen vor Ort und die stehen unter einem wahnsinnigen Druck und es braucht diesen Schutz von diesen Leuten durch klare Worte. Und es geht aber zweitens noch um was ganz was anderes, es geht um die Glaubwürdigkeit der EU selbst. Was mir da in letzter Zeit auch noch gefehlt hat, muss ich auch sagen, ist zum Beispiel auch Kommentare von der EU-Außenbeauftragten in diesem Sinne. Die EU ist überhaupt, also die EU ist natürlich jetzt auch verallgemeinert, aber wenn ich es jetzt zum Beispiel angeschaut habe im Vergleich, wie der US-Botschafter in jüngster Zeit in Mazedonien, in Skopje reagiert hat, auf das, was vorgefallen ist in Kumanovo, dann war das so ungleich, viel stärker und kritischer. Er hat gesagt, the continued inaction casts serious doubt on the commitment of Macedonia's continued Macedonia's commitment to the democratic principles and values of the Euro-Atlantic community. Continued failure to demonstrate this commitment with concrete actions will undermine Macedonia's progress towards EU and NATO membership. Das waren sehr klare Worte von Jess Bailey. Prinzipiell glaube ich, handelt es sich so um drei große Phänomenfelder, wie diese Medienlandschaft oder die Mediensituation beeinflusst wird von der Politik. Das heißt, es werden einerseits politische Realitäten gar nicht mehr berichtet. Das heißt, es gibt für viele Leute einfach überhaupt keinen Zugang mehr zu Informationen. Ich war ja auch jetzt zweimal in Kumanovo, wo diese Feuergefechte waren zwischen diesen Kriminellen und Sicherheitskräften. Und die Leute haben mich als ausländische Journalistin da angefleht, ich soll ihnen irgendeine Information geben, was da passieren wird und was in Zukunft mit ihnen sein wird. Die sind total verängstigt und eingeschüchtert und die wissen einfach wirklich nicht mehr, sie können auch niemandem mehr trauen, weil diese Situation mit diesen Medien, speziell in Mazedonien, ist so, dass man einfach wirklich sich darauf nicht verlassen kann, was da kommt. Es gibt sozusagen einen massiven Vertrauensverlust und großes Misstrauen in der Bevölkerung. Das Zweite, was da passiert, ist eben diese Rolle von diesen Politmedien, würde ich mal sagen, die gegen die Gegner eingesetzt werden, also Zivilgesellschaft und so weiter und so fort. Und die auch über, das darf man nicht vergessen, über sehr viel Geld verfügen, die Anwälte haben. Ja? Also wer sich traut, sozusagen diese Medien wieder zu kritisieren, der kriegt sofort irgendwelche Briefe von Anwälten und der wird mit massiven Drohungen belastet. Viele Medien können sich das ja auch gar nicht leisten, dann da weiterzumachen, weil wenn die Justiz auch korrupt ist, dann speist sich quasi die Katze in den Schwanz, dann kann man da gar nichts mehr machen. Ich möchte auch nur sagen, dass ich nicht glaube, dass es an fehlenden Berichten über diese Situation, also es fehlt nicht an Berichten, das ist immer wieder an die EU-Kommission weitergetragen worden und so weiter. Es ist, glaube ich, hat das, also und das möchte ich schon sagen, hat das in den Fortschrittsberichten der EU in den vergangenen Jahren einfach nicht mehr wirklich Eingang, oder man hat das sozusagen, das war so weich gezeichnet, zum Beispiel, was der Sascha erwähnt hat, 2010, als der TV-Sender A1 geschlossen wurde. Ja? Ich habe jetzt nachgeschaut, was damals die EU-Kommission in ihrem Fortschrittsbericht geschrieben hat. Die haben da geschrieben, also dieses Schließen dieses kritischen TV-Senders raised concerns about the proportionality and selectivity of the procedure. Ja, sehr kritisch, ne? Also da muss man schon sehr zwischen den Zeilen lesen können, um das wirklich als Kritik wahrzunehmen. Ich denke mir, dass die Regierungen in der Region, viele von denen einfach zum Schluss gekommen sind, dass es weniger kostspielig ist, für diese Einschränkung der Medienfreiheit ein bisschen nämlich so zu kritisiert zu werden, als irgendwas zu ändern. Ja, das zahlt sich für die aus. Noch ein letzter Punkt vielleicht. Im ersten Panel ist viel auch gesprochen worden über diese, sozusagen, ob diese ausländischen Geldgeber jetzt, ob das auch zu einer, sozusagen, ob das auch eine Art von Einflussnahme sein könnte auf objektive Berichterstattung. Und da fällt mir was ganz, also das ist mir in den letzten Monaten vermehrt aufgefallen, es gibt so einen Tendenz zu einem Glauben an eine Verschwörung. Ja? Und dieses Verschwörungsnarrativ, das wird in diesen Politorganen die ganze Zeit rauf und runter geschrieben. Also diese Verschwörungsszenerie ist irgendwie so. Die Opposition und die kritischen Medien sind irgendwie dasselbe. Es gibt überhaupt niemanden mehr, der eine Außensicht einnehmen kann. Und die sind alle unter dem Generalverdacht, in irgendeinem Dienst zu stehen. Also meistens werden dann irgendwelche ausländischen Geheimdienste genannt. Und da wird aber dann so getan, als würde es überhaupt keine Möglichkeit geben, Objektivität und Unabhängigkeit zu wahren als Medien. Alles wird eben dann relativiert und aus diesem Gesichtspunkt des innenpolitischen Kampfes gedeutet. Und im Umkehrschluss bedeutet das aber dann, dass alle, die für diese kritischen Medien arbeiten oder noch arbeiten, Landesverräter sind oder eben von irgendwem kontrolliert sind. Ja? Und in dem Weltbild gibt es dann einfach nur die Patrioten und die Verräter. In Mazedonien ist zum Beispiel ganz extrem dieser Soros, unter Soros-Verdacht zu kommen. Also es ist ja wie, die Leute haben Angst, dass man glauben könnte, dass sie vom Soros bezahlt sind. Also weil dieses Bild der Verschwörung schon so wahnsinnig groß ist. Und diese ganze Sache hat einen Einfluss auch auf ausländische Medien. Das ist mein letzter Punkt hier, weil diese Informationspolitik, die von diesen Regierungen ausgeht, in einem Ausmaß oft manipulativ ist, wie man sich das in Mitteleuropa einfach nicht vorstellen kann. Ich möchte das berühmte Beispiel nur. Für mich war das auch wirklich sehr schockierend zu sehen, dieses Fußballspiel, das da hier schon heute einmal angesprochen worden ist. Ich kann mich erinnern, ich bin am Schreibtisch gesessen in Sarajevo und habe dann irgendwie halt verschiedenste Meldungen dazu angeschaut. Und da war dann zum Beispiel CNN. Und CNN hat geschrieben, zuerst war das berühmte Fußballspiel Serbien-Albanien, ich glaube 15. Oktober 2014, das dann ja abgebrochen werden musste, weil das in Chaos und Gewalt geendet hat. Und da war die CNN, die erste Schlagzeile war Brother of Albanian Prime Minister controlled drone at football match. Ich habe das angeschaut und mir gedacht, das gibt's ja nicht. Wie kann CNN das berichten? Ich habe zu dem Zeitpunkt schon angerufen gehabt in Tirana und habe wusste, dass das einfach ein Riesenblödsinn ist. Ja? So, eine halbe Stunde später oder eine Stunde später war dann der Titel Serbian official told CNN that drone was controlled by Ozi Rama. Das ist der Name von diesem Bruder von dem Premierminister. Und dann zum Schluss war Albanian Prime Minister's brother disgusted by drone allegations. So ist es dann, hat sich das in dem, was ich damit sagen wollte, ich will jetzt nicht CNN angreifen, aber die konnten ganz einfach nicht glauben, dass das Büro vom Premierminister selbst diese Propaganda aussendet. Das ist einfach sowas von unfassbar gewesen, nicht nur für CNN. Und deswegen wollte ich auch sagen, dass es in dem Sinn auch nicht egal sein kann, weil wir ausländischen Journalisten oder Medien in Europa oder wie auch immer auch betroffen sind von dieser Desinformationspolitik. Ja.
Good evening, everyone. I'd like first to thank the Heinrich Böll Stiftung for raising the issue of media non-freedom in Southeastern Europe, an issue which is much more important than it might seem at first glance, for obvious reasons. If there are no free in media, then no reforms can be implemented because the society cannot be informed. Well, it might seem that simple to you, but it doesn't seem simple in our region at all, because people who lived for a long time in various forms of communism don't have any idea what actually freedom is. And when someone from the EU would say, it was mentioned before, well, you, the media should survive on a market principle, they tend to forget that all the countries from the Western Balkans that are not members of the EU and are some are candidates, some are aspiring, are not even market economists. They do not have the status of a market economy. How would we expect then to have a market, a media market, if we don't have a market economy? I have a prepared presentation. I hope that you have it. No, you don't have it? Okay, I gave the USB to someone, but obviously the wrong guy. Anyway, I'll try to retell it. It has been mentioned several times during this conference, the different places of countries in the region in the Press Freedom Index. What is important, however, is what is behind the data. And if you see the data, you would see that, for example, Bulgaria currently stands at the place 106 out of 180 countries. You have already heard about the place of Macedonia, which has not even started negotiations, not to mention being a member. It is 117. And Montenegro, which is negotiating for 2 years now, three actually, is seated at 114. What is important, however, is to mention the evolution, or let's put it more correctly, the devolution. Bulgaria, when it signed the accession treaty in 2005, was ranked by the Press Freedom Index as 48th. Can you imagine in 10 years what happened in that country which has been for 8 years a member of the European Union? This is almost 60 seats downwards. Macedonia is a very, very interesting case as well. In 2005, when the European Commission and the Council gave a green light for Macedonia to begin negotiations, and for 10 years it never did, was actually ranked 43rd. 43rd. And now it is 117. You can do the math, what happened in 10 years with no negotiations and no European perspective. And Montenegro, well, actually, not much of a change there, although it is negotiated as well. And what is the difference and the common thing between these three worst performing countries? Like I said, Bulgaria has been a member of the European Union for 8 years. Montenegro is negotiating. Macedonia is doing nothing but imploding. In the same time, the European Union was very busy with Hungary, with the growing autocracy and the pressure on media as well. Do you have any idea where is Hungary in the Press Freedom Index? In 2015, it is 65. Well, it is almost 40 seats behind Bulgaria. And why was Bulgaria not in the spotlight then, one would legitimately ask, especially if you take into account that Bulgaria has joined the European Union with a mechanism that was supposed to help the country complete, not start, complete reforms in the judiciary, fight the corruption and organized crime. It joined with that mechanism together with Romania. Let me just mention to you, where is Romania in the Press Freedom Index? Romania is 52nd in 2015, and in 2007, when it joined together with Bulgaria, it was 42nd, so not much of a difference, you would say. And in the same time, the two countries, Bulgaria and Romania, joined with the same mechanism. This is where Romania is in terms of press freedom, and in terms of fighting corruption, Romania at this stage is a star. As we currently joke, both in Romania and Bulgaria, Romanians now have an entire government in prison for corruption. Yeah, former ministers, members of parliament, mayors, whatever, you name it. Many people on the list. And how is this perceived in Bulgaria? Well, their judiciary is not as good as ours. Bulgaria doesn't have a single high official in prison for corruption. So how come that we have one mechanism that works so differently in two countries? Well, this is the attention of the European Union. And here comes again Macedonia. Nobody paid attention to Macedonia for 10 years. 10 years, a decade, nobody even knew Macedonia existed. And the European Union would just say, well, you have a name issue with Greece, deal with it and come back for membership. They wouldn't get involved. They wouldn't see what the actual problem is. And actually, Greece, is it the right position? Greece is part of the European Union, but is it right the European Union to behave like this without getting involved? What if Greece's position is wrong? So, Macedonia, no attention. Montenegro, it's too small. Even if it's corrupt, we'll handle it. Bulgaria, well, there is a mechanism there that works. In the same time, Hungary, lots of media attention. At least 5 hearings in the European Parliament. And the peak of that was that just a few weeks ago, the Prime Minister of Hungary attended a debate on the freedom of speech and all the problems that that are currently in Hungary in the European Parliament. And he also took part in that debate. This never happened with Bulgaria. With Romania, in 2012, when the European Commission was supposed to publish a summary of the functioning of the that mechanism I was telling you about, we nickname it, the abbreviation is CVM. It was 5 years then, and the European Commission was supposed to make a summary, but at the time there was a huge political crisis in Romania, lots of political interference on the constitutional court, various courts, and you know, pretty much familiar things in the whole region. And then the Commission entirely changed the report on Romania, and instead of making a summary, it focused very much on pointing out the problems and that this is not supposed to happen in a EU member country. Furthermore, the European Commission threatened, and it did it, to come up with an extraordinary report. It did it 6 months later, and there it was really blunt. It even said, you should resign even when there are just doubts about you being involved in corruption or any other accusations that are not suitable to our EU values. And there, the European Commission, in that same report, paid a lot of attention on media. Nothing of that happened in terms of Bulgaria. And where is Bulgaria now? Bulgaria lives in two parallel universes. And this is thanks to the media empire that was built in the past less than 10 years under the watch of the government, the parliament, and the civil society. And what does this media do? it tries to suppress every critical opinion. And the very good illustration of that was in 2013. By the way, Macedonia absolutely replicated the entire scenario that happened in Bulgaria. The owner of that media empire, who is called Delian Pevsky, we joke, although this is a sad thing, a very young man who has developed such a stunning political career and wealth, nobody knows how. And nobody asks, or even if someone asks, there's no answer. So that guy, who has been various things, from member of parliament to judge to anything, you name it, was named ahead of the most powerful security agency in Bulgaria, the Agency for National Security. That was it. This unleashed a huge protest. There were thousands of people. I haven't seen such a protest since the early days when the communism fell. There were tens of thousands of people who demanded this guy to go. And these protests last for months because people realized that actually removing Mr. Pevsky from this nomination would not resolve the problem of actually who is behind that nomination. And now the word, that simple question, who, has become a nickname for demanding democracy, for demanding media freedom, for demanding being a normal European country in the standards of the old member states. And what did Mr. Pevsky's empire? It started destroying the reputation of the most active participants in the protests. They've been nicknamed, what has happened in Macedonia as well, as Sorosoids, as being paid by Mr. Soros or foreign aid, whereas in the same time, the government and who is behind it has been was organizing with buses counter-protests, which actually were financed with public money because parties are being financed by the taxpayers. So all this has remained off the radar of the European Union, too busy with so many crises. But why is this very wrong? Because Bulgaria is a case study, and everybody acknowledges that thanks to the failure of Bulgaria and Romania and that mechanism, the European Commission changed its enlargement strategy. It changed it even during the accession of negotiations with Croatia, but Montenegro is the first country that actually started the negotiations from the most difficult chapters, that's 23 and 24. And this is happening with all the other candidate countries. The idea is to avoid the same mistakes that were made with Bulgaria and Romania. But I wonder why the European Union is not paying attention on the current developments in Bulgaria. And this is actually a recipe for making the same mistake with the enlargement countries, because the European Union would say, okay, we've changed the enlargement strategy, now everything should be okay. No, it's not, because the European Union is making the same mistake as in the previous panel Svetlana was talking about. Lots of state-owned media and outlets will be privatized. Who is going to buy them? And let me again remind you, you don't have a market economy in Serbia. You don't have rules, you don't have institutions that secure, that are the foundations for a market economy, not to mention functioning democracy. So how is the European Union doesn't have many tools, especially in terms of countries that are members of the European Union. But as Andreas said in the beginning, he was actually quoting the Deputy Prime Minister of Serbia, who is a foreign minister, Ivica Dačić, last year at a forum in Dubrovnik. He actually said it quite bluntly, half jokingly, half seriously, that all the EU member countries should go through regular health checks. And then most of the current EU member states, even the old ones, would fail. Well, actually, he's right. But he's using this argument to say you don't have the right to demand us do any of the reforms you have failed in your European Union. If Bulgaria and Romania are that terrible and deteriorating, why would you want us to do anything that is different? We are the same as Bulgaria and Romania. Why not join now? Does this sound legitimate? Yes. Does this ruin the credibility of the European Union? Yes. What do we need to do? Tackle the problems in the European Union first, and then show that we can handle it. Thank you.
Ich höre, Manuel wird ungeduldig und will widersprechen. Wir haben die Strategie des Transformationsprozesses, sagen jetzt hier auf der Tagesordnung. Es werden Zweifel geäußert, ob das sagen, Transformationsversprechen der angewandten Kriterien, Kopenhagen-Kriterien auf neue Beitrittsländer funktioniert. Und wir sind jetzt im Reality-Check im Balkan mit Blick auf schlechte Beispiele in der unmittelbaren Nachbarschaft. Vielleicht können wir noch ein Stichwort mit dazu nehmen. Wenn man sich die Situation näher anguckt, sieht man, dass es oft eine auch ungute Rolle der europäischen Parteien gibt, sozusagen die sozusagen bestimmte Interessen der Ausdehnung sozusagen ihres Einflussbereichs auch haben. Und die zum Teil, Stichwort Orban, aber auch Stichwort Djukanovic oder auch Gruevski, ihre schützende Hand sozusagen auch über sozusagen die jeweiligen Regierenden halten. Also das Stichwort Parteien, möglicherweise auch Parteienstiftungen, wir sind ja als solche hier auch unterwegs sozusagen, zeigen allerdings, dass wir hier sozusagen mit offenem Visier arbeiten, weil wir sozusagen das selbstkritisch auch angehen. Also ein Stichwort noch, Parteien, die ein strategisches Interesse natürlich an der Erweiterung ihres Einflusses auf der Ebene des Europäischen Parlaments haben. Manuel.
Vielleicht kann man da, also ich habe mal mitverhindert, dass eine mazedonische Partei in die EGP aufgenommen wird. Once I was one of the guys trying to organize that the Macedonian party is not getting observer membership in the European Green Party. So not everybody recognized in the EGP what guys or lady this one were. So perhaps the Greens are a bit better because we are even so having no success in this region, sometimes it's a chance, sometimes also a problem, but that's a different topic. I mean, you meant this reality check is really interesting and we should always be aware of this reality, but in the end, nobody said, and I think nobody would say that giving up the transformation model of trying to do it via enlargement promise, Thessaloniki agenda and enlargement procedure would be the right one. And I think this is quite true. I mean, if you look to the data of transformation worldwide, all the European member states are the top runners of it. The 2004 enlargement wave, they're the top runners. About the first 20 ranks, you have like almost all of them. Even Romania, Bulgaria are under the least of this ones, but better than the most other models worldwide. And if you then compare it with the states in our direct neighborhood which haven't had a membership perspective at all, like Ukraine, for example, or Russia or Belarus, you see that, I mean, the record is much better at least there. So it's a kind of absurd situation, which I think you need to have a heart for Kafka, for example, to understand the magics of enlargement procedures. It's an absurd situation. And we should accept that it's absurd, and we should try to play in this gray field and play the right ball. But I think that when I was getting a bit dizzy, I think all this Romania-Bulgaria stuff, you know, actually nobody at all can come with this argument anymore, because there is for years already the one and simple answer. And frankly speaking, every official of every state on the Western Balkan knows the story to tell me a different story, which is quite easy. Romania and Bulgaria, if you are as bad as they are, I will never get German parliament voting your accession treaty. Never, ever. I need to have the argument in front of the German electorate that you are better than they are. Otherwise, I will never get it. And everybody's telling us, of course, that we will be better because they are so dumb. So I'm not so sure if always this is true, but the argument is not that one. I think the biggest danger in the moment is that a mix of two points is going to be used much more by the governments there, which are not stupid points. It's a strategic point about strategic situation, Ukraine, all the stuff. And it's also the situation of, you know, you always have, in enlargement situations, you always have kind of momentum. And you, of course, you always make some kind of rebate to gain the momentum, to have a dynamic. This was always the way. I mean, in 2004, Poland wasn't perfect. There still was corruption. There still was violence in the justice system. There still was problems in media. It's always the question of the process and the transformation process is on the right way, and the progress will go on more or less. Which principle, which decision will bring the process getting on more? Giving a say that, yes, you made something right, or being tough and you're not good enough at all. And I mean, you know, it's always difficult to wage. I mean, the argument of the Serbian government is we need for our ongoing reforms, we need the political support by opening up a chapter to prove that we did something and that we are on the track and we have a hope that there is this perspective. See Macedonia. And the counter argument is, of course, that, I mean, is this government really doing enough to open chapters now and to not start with 23 perhaps, but open some other chapters which are more easy to give them this this ground at home. And then you always have this question of enlargement fatigue or not. I mean, this is an old game. Perhaps the difference is that situation on the Balkan is different due to some reasons. And one of the points is that the peace project of Europe is so much overwhelming, and this is a chance, of course, for all the elites. Sometimes, I mean, some time ago, we were sitting in a secret meeting with all the foreign ministers from the region and a lot of others, you know, and some people attending there had afterwards the impression that these guys might say, okay, we are all friends and brothers and we love each other, peace forever, but don't count on democracy so much anymore. And this is something which is, I mean, it's not so easy to wage as well. I mean, if you put on a wage peace between Kosovo and Serbia and democratization and transformation of Serbia and Kosovo. I mean, this is not an easy situation. It's really important that European Union is clear in saying this is not enough. We have the clear transformation scheme and we have the Copenhagen criteria. But of course, not in every single decision this will be easy to say or this will be exact to say, because always the question of the momentum is there to follow. And for this, it's a really, I mean, the reality check can always be a problem. With the media freedom, I think there's one main problem there. I mean, there's one problem with the structure of the countries, you know, small countries, market economy question, you know, involvement of state into this. You named Hungary, for example, which is much more extreme in countries of your region. But there's also one interesting point, which is perhaps from the German perspective important to say. The credibility lack of media, also in Germany, is increasing. And the new situation of new media, of different difficulties in financing, and of ideological and hybrid warfare, is also a problem over here. So the credibility of media in Germany, for example, is highly under pressure by propaganda from Russia, for example. So, I mean, the situation of media is not so easy to compare anymore to say that this is the German model. We put, I think it's about like 7 billion to 10 billion euros a year in public media every year, 7 to 10 billion. About half a billion is for German football, to see it freely. So, I mean, but this is not so easy to say anymore. The old German system was, you know, you have this huge amount of money, which is vastly spent for TV shows and crime, Tatort movies. But it was also quite, you know, in a system of all the parties get a share, doesn't matter of opposition or government, which is probably better than the systems in your states. But on the other hand, there was always a deal. If the leftists get a political magazine, conservatives also get the next one, you know. So it's not totally free from political influence. But I think the situation is that media is getting more difficult even here. We have a problem of credibility of media here. So the situation for the European Union to look over there and to guide is a problem, because this argument of double standards will occur. But I think this argument of double standards is not the one problem. I think that, I mean, the argument is, okay, Romania and Bulgaria are not so good, we don't care because they don't have to get a treaty signed in German parliament. This is an argument which is quite tough, and everybody can say, but you made a mistake with Romania and Bulgaria. Okay, perhaps it was a mistake, I don't know, but you're on the desk now. I have to stand this in front of my electorate. I think the point is that the methods and the models which are used are quite tricky. And it's not so, I mean, it's not in the way that you can easily say this is going into autocracy. It's not in the way that it's easy to find the system, the model, there is the one thing which should be done in the countries and then everything will be fine. And my point is always that in this enlargement processes, we have to get civil society more involved, and we have to also get public awareness so that the public is able to follow up what's negotiated and so on. And of course you need media for that, but it's not in the way that the system which I used are too easy to guess. I mean, it's like you said, you say that the media in the region is vastly influenced by public spending, for example, in Macedonia, but if you privatize them, you will have same guys probably with at least perhaps one corner around again having control over there. So, I mean, this is the problem European Union is facing. In having solutions, of course, I cannot say that there's the one solution, because I think European Union has to look at every country and trying to be clear and blunt and well enough informed to say something. But of course, in the concrete situations, there will be always the political question of dynamics and momentum in behind. Regarding Angela Merkel, because one of you, I think, hopefully said trust brings responsibility. But never forget that Angela Merkel's biggest responsibility is her elections at home. And I try to explain this to everybody across Europe. And it's important also, I mean, Mr. Cameron underestimates sometimes, Mr. Tsipras or Mr. Varoufakis underestimates, everybody underestimates. She really minds the most about her power at home. And second, I think she has an idea about the situation of the world today and about the responsibility of having success in this region, because otherwise there will be really this strategic situation coming up. You know, I was last time with the European Committee in Albania, and we had talks with, I mean, some backbenchers from German Parliament, but they are important because we are kind of the lobbyists for these countries in German Parliament. And it's always the job of going there, getting all the bad information, the clear, and then going home and going to the colleagues and trying to put this in a constructive way that they still believe that it's sensible to go on with enlargement procedure. Because, you know, I mean, this is a kind of pedagogics, but if the reaction is so, oh, this region is so bad, let's better not touch it, it's the wrong outcome of it. And the Albanian government is really stressing on this argument of strategic situation. I mean, they have some consolation of one former Green, quite important person, who is telling them, put the strategic argument, which is quite true, and I mean, there is an argument. Albania is a real strategic key country, perhaps more than Serbia even, although Serbia is having the story for a longer time. But they shouldn't underestimate that if we want to stand the enlargement process at home, in the new situation of German parliament is in different steps again and again tabling it, we need to have the transformation record on the ground, and we will not believe too easily what commission or governments write us down, because we are talking also to you guys. This is my answer. It is not the solution, but I stop here.
Wir sind in der Zeit schon recht fortgeschritten. Ich nehme jetzt trotzdem noch zwei, drei Fragen vielleicht, wenn Sie welche haben. Einmal das Mikro bitte gleich dorthin. Noch eine andere Frage? Okay. dann kommen wir erstmal zu Ihnen.
My name is Andreas Wildenwood. I have a question to Sasha Ordanowski. My question is about what you said. Where are the Albanians in all this? For instance, there's an Albanian party in government, which actually supplied the majority of the Vemuro. And what is their role in the degradation of Macedonian democracy in the last years? Are there only onlookers and bystanders, or that would be quite interesting? And maybe you could say something about Kumanovo.
Vielleicht, wenn ich intervenieren darf, Bodo Weber, der hat gerade auch im Auftrag der Böll-Stiftung sozusagen eine methodologische Untersuchung zu den Progress Reports durchgeführt, und die wurden als methodisch in hier und dort jedenfalls als mangelhaft oder als zweifelhaft dargestellt. Vielleicht kommen wir noch kurz auf dich zu. Bitte schön.
Ich wollte nur Kommentar abgeben. Offensichtlich ist die Regierung in Mazedonien zum Beispiel bemüht, also privates Sender zu schließen, aber gleichzeitig ist die EU zum Beispiel bemüht, staatliche Sender zu schließen, wie in Griechenland. Also die haben das zugemacht und alles.
Doch.
Wie kommentieren Sie das? Ja, das ist eine Sache. Sie haben gesagt, also Frau Marini, dass zum Beispiel, also dass jemand, also wegen nur Verdacht auf Korruption eigentlich abtreten sollte. Also dass jemand euch dann in ich wollte nur ein Stichwort Schäuble sagen, also der hat so einen ziemlichen Korruptionsrekord, also in Deutschland, und kam nie auf die Idee, sowas zu tun. Teilweise. Ich meine, was ich sage, und noch eine dritte Sache, mir scheint, dass das in ganze Verhandlung mit dem Beitritt zur Europäischen Union, geht es einfach, dass man ein Regelwerk entwickelt hat. Okay? Was man eigentlich sagen will, wir haben die Formel. Das ist, was Sie sagen. Wir haben die Formel. Und wenn ihr euch benimmt, wie wir das in diesem Regelwerk vorsehen, dann werdet ihr eine schöne, glückliche Gesellschaft bilden können. Ja? Ich finde, dass das nicht unbedingt anwendbar ist. Also vor allem, also dass diese Implementierung, also die Europäische Union, also das durchzieht, ist auf eine technokratische Basis runtergestuft. Also genau wie die mit Griechenland Verhandlung oder Troika und sowas. Also das geht einfach um sture Implementierung der Regelwerk, der schon vorgegeben ist. Ja? Dass das nicht so viel wirklich Erfolg bringt, also ist genau der Beweis der Westbalkanländer. Und diese Degradation zum Beispiel, die man in Rumänien und in Bulgarien feststellen kann. Ja. Trotzdem also ist niemand auf die Idee gekommen, okay, wir könnten vielleicht doch ein bisschen was ändern. Ja, das war's. Ja, gut.
Ich will nur sozusagen einen kurzen Kommentar dazwischen schalten. Als entschieden wurde, dass die Verhandlungen mit Serbien beginnen sollten, wollte die Europäische Union, dass die Zivilgesellschaft, die serbische Zivilgesellschaft sozusagen einen Platz bei den Verhandlungen bekommt. Auf Bitten der serbischen Regierung wurde das dann sozusagen weggelassen. Also das wäre sozusagen schon auch ein Ansatz, sozusagen in diesen Verhandlungsprozess sozusagen auch Stimmen mit einzubauen, sozusagen die sozusagen über sozusagen die technokratische Implementierung von Regeln hinausgehen, sondern die sozusagen aus der Situation des Landes heraus sozusagen Reformbedarf artikulieren, der in diesen Verhandlungen dann eine Sprache bekommt. Bitte jetzt.
Bodo Weber from the Democratization Policy Council. Mr. Poltman has just mentioned that we've just finished a report, an analysis of the Serbia Progress Report. Actually, it's an analysis of the Serbia Progress Report throughout the starting with the current one, but throughout comparing the Serbia Progress Report in
key reform area throughout the years. And one of this is the famous aspect of media. Unfortunately, I could not join participate in the first panel, but I assume that it was mentioned that at the press conference in October in Belgrade, when the head of the EU delegation, Special Representative Mr. Davenport, handed over the report to Prime Minister Vucic, there was an open scandal or conflict between Mr. Vucic and Mr. Davenport. Actually, it was a very one-sided conflict because there was only one side criticizing the report. And this was Mr. Vucic, and the critique went to the part referring to media. Now, I don't want to go into many details, but I think there you got two interesting aspects. The one is Mr. Vucic made a differentiation provoked by one journalist who dared to ask a critical question, and he later got into, as a footnote, into a quarrel with that journalist that in the meantime is not working for this media anymore. By the way, a media owned by foreign companies, one of them being the built the Springer company, which is also, I think, very interesting. Maybe that will be an aspect of looking into the role of foreign media companies that bought big medias in the region over the last 20 years and whether this has either contributed to media pluralism or they have adjusted to the local rules of the game. I would say the latter is the case. Coming back to the differentiation that Mr. Vucic made, he clarified that he is not disagreeing on both parts in the progressive front that refer to the media, but that he agrees, as far as I remember, to the part that is entitled Media and Information Society, but he does not agree on the part that is entitled Freedom of Expression. This is a very interesting differentiation for two reasons, because it shows what you've already mentioned, that not only the whole EU integration mechanism and the toolbox with the chapters, with the benchmarks, opening, closing, interim, has changed after the negative experience with Bulgaria and Romania, but it is in fact a work in progress. A work in progress managed by a bureaucratic institution as is the European Commission. And this creates a very interesting dynamics and a very, I would even say, a kind of institutional insecurity. Now come back to this differentiation. Why is this important? And this comes back to the critique and this example of Ms. Wolfie about the elements of whitewashing in the progress reports. Media is covered in the accession process, in the integration process, under two categories. The one is in a chapter as part of harmonization of legislation. That's media and information society. This is a very legalistic, technical part, and that provoked not the critique of Mr. Vucic, which I think is not coincidental. Freedom of expression is part of the so-called political criteria, establishment of a solid democratic relations. Now here again, we have a very interesting situation which shows the work in progress. The legal document that defines the political criteria, the Copenhagen criteria, also formally legally ascribes that the fulfillment, the sufficient fulfillment of political criteria is deemed fulfilled when accession process starts or negotiation starts, or I think even when the candidate status is granted. Now in practice, we can very clearly see on the one side that this is an absolute insufficient condition. And on the other side, in the practice of the EU integration policy of the Commission has long time gone beyond that very formal legal condition. That's why we still have, even after granting candidate status on one side, a political criteria paragraph, a long one, including on the stage situation of freedom of expression in the progress reports. And that's why in practice, especially for EU member states, when the voting on various stages in accession process comes to the Bundestag or other member states, there the political criteria still plays a very crucial role. So this just as an illustration of this work in progress that of course gives very, very unclear and very, very less fixed instruments at hand to such a bureaucratic institution as the European Commission. Even more so, and Mr. Orlanowski has mentioned the framework, if we are in a political situation like we have in Macedonia or maybe still are, or we have been in other constellations in Bosnia, where we have a problem with the EU integration because of the local political elites that pretend they want to have an EU's perspective and they have an EU pro-EU integration policy, and if there is no political will, and that does not mean in the Commission, but within the European Union, that means among the member states, at all interested in the region, then of course the European Commission has a problem with its tool. And then it starts to maneuver, navigate, and starts to create such whitewashing formulations like Mrs. Wolfi has just quoted from the 2010 report on Macedonia. Thank you.
Well, there are several questions. I totally disagree with this relativization, and Manuel, you did this. Look, I'm a specialist on media systems. I know the theory, I know the practice. And I'm not talking here about the difference between the Italian model and German model and how the public money is spent in France and how the public money is spent in Poland. I showed you 9 cases in 7 weeks of government-sponsored violence against people in the media and freedom of expression people. Not a single reaction from the European Union. Don't give me this bureaucratic language about the chapters and this and that. We have a 5-story building of European Commission in the center of Skopje. Not a single reaction. You know, we have ambassador, we have I don't know how many deputies, we have 50-100 diplomats from European Commission. So I appreciate when we come to this, you know, theoretization, what is this and what is that. We have a government which is violently attacking everybody who is against them. And if that is not noticed, then let's stop this whole negotiation, enlargement, and all this kind of, well, to stay in the correct language, what word to use not to be bullshit. So, sorry. So, this is what I'm saying. So, I understand all this kind of, you know, political this and that and everything. We have a very violent government. It hasn't been condemned. On Albanians. Albanian party, which is the biggest party, which is part of the government, is absolutely deep into the criminality together with Macedonian party. They use 2 excuses why they're still in the government. One, they say that if they leave the government, then the nationalistic Vemero party, the governing party, will actually immediately go to the nationalistic vocabulary and then to the chauvinistic platform. And then you will have the seize, you will have the end of this civil society and civil movement, then we'll have to get into the trenches of nationalism. So that's, it sounds to me like a good argument. And then they will have also to answer on the Albanian nationalistic base. That's one thing. And the other thing is that pressed by the Americans, they sit in the government to try to balance and to control as much as they can what the government is actually doing in this very dirty times and very dirty business. Now, if they leave the government, then there is no government. But they are using these 2 excuses, and the 3rd one, which they are not saying, is with the one that I started with. They are part of the criminalities. They are not even close to the numbers of the Macedonians. But you know, one of the things that Gruevski is doing, since they learned the lesson, I'm going just to take 2 more minutes. One of the pillars of his governance is the changed nationalistic relations to the ethnic Albanians. They learned in 2001 and from the 90s that aggressive nationalism doesn't pay off. So they have come to the level there where they're demonstrating their how do you say this in English, they're despising Albanians. You know, what is the German word for to despise? Sorry? Yeah. So, you know, how is it? Look, we don't like you, but we have to tolerate you. What do you want? We want 10. This is 12, and shut up. That's I'm even very little kind of distorting what, how it looks like. And Albanians are accepting this kind of position. That's why DUI, which is the biggest party, is very delegitimized among the voters. But then when the voting day comes, you know, you choose from the options you have. And then again you have these big party beasts who are competing. And, but I have to say that there is a big rationalization among the Albanians as well. Look, people, I mean, European Union is fighting for 25 years for exactly the thing that is now happening in Skopje. Albanians and Macedonians fighting together against the non-democrats and not using ethnic arguments. And what I face a whole day in Berlin today, I had six meetings, European Union, actually Germany, doesn't know which side to take. And you have spent I don't know how many billions of taxpayers' money in Germany in the last 25 years to reach this stage. And now we have seven statements by Mr. Lavrov, not a single one by the German foreign minister. Why is Mr. Lavrov more interested in Macedonia than the German foreign minister? Is anybody here can answer this to me? And we are not asking for statements which will start a war or end the war. Simply a semi-sentence which will support democracy. Zero. And you know, everyone today asked me, these 30 people we met, nice people otherwise, most of them know very well what's going on. What can we do? Come on.
I think that the man over there behind raised a very important issue. It is true, and I have it here, that the political criteria need to be implemented first before a country to start to have a candidate status. However, for political reasons, a gap has been established between receiving the candidate status and starting the actual negotiations. In the case of Macedonia, you have 10 years. In 10 years, Macedonia no longer meets the political criteria. And what is the European Commission going to do? Is it going to turn to the first phase and say, well, we're sorry, but the auction is closed, you have to apply again? Or is it going to step over its own rules and start negotiations in that poor state in which Macedonia is? And that applies to Serbia, because Serbia seems to be following the path of Macedonia. It has received a candidate status. It hasn't opened any chapter yet. And as it seems, it's not going to open any chapter anytime soon because of the really tough conditionality set before that, completely justified. I'm not saying that they shouldn't. But this creates a lot of problems afterwards, although all these measures are being taken for good reasons, but then they're fired back, as is the case in Macedonia, as will be the case with Serbia. There are two positions which are contradictory, but a solution needs to be found. On the one hand, because you have geopolitics here, which plays a crucial role, and which will play a crucial role, which means that the European Union will have to compromise with some of its underlying values. Now, if you don't start negotiations with Serbia, Serbia and its population is not pro-European. Imagine what will happen in a region which has become highly volatile in recent days. But if you start negotiations with Serbia, well, where will they lead? Because on the other hand, you have a very tough partner, which is criticizing every European move and is giving examples of weak points like Bulgaria, Romania, you name it. And what is crucial, however, for the European Union to have in mind every time is that if you have unresolved issues, if you import them in the European Union, then this is weakening the Union itself. And Greece is a wonderful example. Because at the time Greece was accepted, the conditions were not that tough. No one actually foresaw what will happen. And lots of compromises were made. For its membership in the Eurozone, as well. Many compromises were made. Everyone knew about the frauds and things like that. And where is it taking this? The entire Eurozone, is it a risk? The same goes with the European Union. If you take a lot of countries which do not apply and do not perceive or do not have these European values as their inherent values, then you have a problem sooner or later. This is a clockwork. One day it will just blow off. So no compromises with the European values. That needs to be a must. But we have the challenge of geopolitics. How to deal with it? I don't have a recipe. I just believe that the European values are a law, and this law should be abode with. That's it.
Ja, ganz kurz zu diesen spielen die Parteifamilien eine Rolle. Natürlich tun die das. Im Fall vom Balkan spielt noch mehr eine Rolle, was Serbien und den Kosovo betrifft, dass die Verhandlungen weitergehen zwischen Serbien und Kosovo, und derweil auf vieles andere halt weniger Wert gelegt wird. Das ist auch klar, das muss man auch pragmatisch so sehen. Was Mazedonien betrifft, glaube ich, ist es also ist ganz klar, dass die Kommission jetzt sagt, okay, wir drohen damit, dass wir die, dass wir die Aufnahme der Verhandlungen, die ja seit 10 Jahren eigentlich empfohlen werden, nicht mehr weiterempfehlen. Und wenn man dann der Kommission sagt, liebe Leute, aber diese Regierung will überhaupt gar keine Verhandlungen, das, mit dem kann man denen nicht drohen, weil das ist für die keine Drohung, sondern das ist... ist denen wurscht, ja, würde ich jetzt mal sagen auf Österreichisch, dann sagen die, ja, das wissen wir, aber was soll man sonst machen? Also ich denke, in der Situation ist, es gibt in Wahrheit keine Strategie. Was ich glaube, was die Medien betrifft, ist ganz kurz und pragmatisch gesagt, um die kritischen Medien zu erhalten, braucht es Geld vom Ausland.
I don't know. Böll Stiftung and critical media in the region. I mean, this is your business, but perhaps, I mean, perhaps you shouldn't talk publicly about everything. Oh, no, this was Ukraine and the Böll Stiftung. Ukraine and the CIA were making the coup d'etat against Yanukovych because it was a great clue of the Americans to do it via Ralph Fuchs. I forgot, sorry. You say truly that one of the biggest problems in the region is that everything is so politicized. And then you come up and you criticize a bureaucratic process and say, let's do it more political. This is not logic. You know why actually the system of enlargement is so bureaucratic? Do you know from where it comes? It comes from the enlargement negotiations between the European Community and the United Kingdom. And the situation that in former times the council was in charge of the negotiations, and it was never possible to get any progress because Charles de Gaulle said, I don't like them, away. And this was the idea to bureaucratize it, to give it to the independent, because the bureaucracy is sometimes great in overbridging unsolvable problems, in making it on pragmatic small stuff, which is totally interesting and nobody is really looking at it. And in the end, it leads somewhere. And of course, we need more political debates now. This is why the member states and the parliaments need to get in more, to have more points of pressure. I mean, if Mr. Vucic has to convince not only the commission, which always has the same problem like me sometimes in the parliament, if I'm saying Serbia is so bad, then everybody at home is answering, so away with them, why we want them? But if they have to convince different parliaments, 27, which are getting more involved. You know, this is, the game is getting more interesting. But in the end, I still believe we need a bureaucratic process, because if we just put political interest anywhere, we will have not the problem solved. Because we see, I mean, the Greece-Macedonia point, it's full of political interest. And then, I mean, with Macedonia and Greece and the name issue, I mean, you know, what to do if an elite doesn't want the accession and place it that way? What can we do against it? We cannot... Yeah, please. I mean, if the moderator...
React on the breaking of the freedom of press. Forget elites. Your ministry states that burning of 7 cars in 7 weeks is unacceptable for the German democracy. Full stop.
Okay, so this is I'm free enough to grant that. Yeah, that's not my problem. But if you have governments in a region or political elites, perhaps even across different party systems, or perhaps a system where opposition and government is more or less part of an arrangement, this is not something which can be changed alone from European Union. This can be only like European Union or the enlargement process should play a role in encouraging change to the system and in the end gathering change. But of course we all know that, I mean, enlargement procedure is doomed to succeed insofar as the elites have to make a process which will in the end cut all the structure of their money flow and their power flow, which is quite much linked to each other, otherwise they will not join. And of course they don't want to. And the only thing which European Union has in the hand to pressure them to get on this track more or less is that they will lose the same earlier if they don't go on this track, because the people will say, but we want the track to Europe. If you are not going to go on that track, we won't elect you anymore. And of course they are trying to influence, you know, via media, via election law, all these tricks we know from the region, from other regions as well. I mean, in different stages and in totally different kind, and not so much Balkanized. For some little things, we also have some people acting like that in Germany. Of course they try to play this. But what I just say is that the magic of enlargement is still that this absurdity of people are forced to do something which is against their own long-term interest, because the European idea is so overwhelming that they have to follow this, at least to show like they would follow, otherwise they will have on short term their interest failed. This is somehow the magic. And this will be always absurd. And of course the most important thing is that you're absolutely true. We need to be clear. And there, your answer or somebody's answer was the point. If the political will is not enough, I mean, if nobody's believing that that Merkel wants Turkey to be in European Union, the pressure potential on Erdogan to change something is smaller than if it's believed that they really like us and they want us. And this is why it's important that still there's trust in Angela Merkel that she wants it, which I hope, I mean, with Turkey, we can see that it has some influence in the wrong direction. And then there is the point with the civil society, which is making it so difficult for us, I mean, from Berlin, for example, to judge. Because in Serbia, you told the story about civil society. In Montenegro, they have civil society involved in a way that other parts of civil society say they're buying in civil society, making de facto governmental NGOs out of it. And so you have to find always, you know, individual scheme, what is fitting to each country. In Serbia, you have different reforms to do, perhaps, I mean, more difficult reforms to do in the justice sector than in Montenegro, than in Albania, than in Macedonia. And on the other hand, we need to have more awareness for the change, but there is not this one role model. Everybody is leading to have the same acquis communautaire, which is more or less the same words in the end. This is one of the next absurdities. And what I'm just trying to formulate is that this fatigue about European Union will not lead to change there. I mean, we should know that European Union is not perfect and it's really bad in being clear sometimes, and this technocratic language and the bureaucrats making the sentences like you quoted, nobody understands anymore. But in the end, I still believe that process is the best we have, and I think that at least the 2004 enlargement was so successful that we shouldn't give up already now and put it to the bullshit part.
Okay. Okay, yeah, yeah. Wir enden jetzt. Okay, vielen Dank jetzt. Erst einmal, nachdem wir zwei Runden mit sehr vielen ja eigentlich erschreckenden Botschaften hatten, war es interessant zu hören, dass am Ende die Politik doch sagen strategische Geduld und Vertrauen in den Erweiterungsprozess die spielt ihre Rolle dort, so etwas, das nach einer solchen Liste von Schreckensbotschaften, die wir hier auch gehört haben, auch wieder fast tröstlich, sozusagen, dass es irgendwie auch im politischen Raum ein Vertrauen sozusagen in diese, wie gesagt, diese strategische Geduld gibt, sozusagen, dass das, was wir heute schrecklich finden, sich immerhin ändern könnte und ändern sollte. Ich lasse es dabei, dass wir wie mit einem gewissen politischen Botschaft der Hoffnung hier aus diesen zwei Runden herausgehen. Bedanke mich sehr bei unseren Dolmetscherinnen, die wie immer sozusagen schnellen und hastigen Reden folgen mussten. Vielen Dank. Vielen Dank für Ihr Interesse. Vielen Dank für alle Podiumsteilnehmerinnen. Und ich entlasse Sie und euch jetzt in den Abend. Vielen Dank.